So let's now turn our attention to the all pairs shortest path problems, where we try to find the paths, shortest paths between every pair of vertices in a graph. So recall that we are working with weighted graphs. We allow negative edge weights but not negative cycles, because with negative cycles the shortest path is not well defined. With negative weights, it is well defined. We saw that the Bellman-Ford algorithm allows us to generalize Dijkstra's algorithm and compute single source shortest paths in weighted graphs with negative weights but without negative cycles. So now we want to further generalize this and compute not just the shortest paths from a single source but the shortest paths between every pair of vertices. So as we explained at the beginning, an example would be if you are trying to run a travel website or an airline website and somebody wants to find the minimum cost or the minimum time flight or train between any pair of cities. So we made the following observation about shortest paths, okay, that a shortest path even in the presence of negative weights will never loop, because we can always remove the loop without increasing the length of the path. So therefore a shortest path never visits the same vertex twice and has length at most n minus 1. So we exploited this algorithm in one way for Bellman-Ford, and we will find that we can use it now for an inductive algorithm for all pairs shortest paths. Right? So we will come up with an inductive solution of how to build up the shortest paths. So we are basically going to build up shortest paths in terms of vaguely their length, but more specifically what vertices we allow in between. So the simplest shortest path you can imagine between a pair of vertices is just a single edge, right? So if you have a single edge and this happens to be the shortest path, then you're in good shape. But in general, this may not be the shortest path, because even if there is such an edge, there may be a way because of edge weights or even because of negative edge weights of reaching from I to J via a longer path of edges, but with a shorter overall cost. But what we do know, because of this characterization of shortest paths, is that this path from I to J goes through some intermediate vertices, all of which are different from each other. No vertex is visited twice. And secondly, none of these vertices is either I or J. There's no point in coming back to I and then going to J. So there is no loop anywhere in this path. So what we will do for this inductive thing is to restrict what can happen in between I and J. Okay, what are the vertices that are allowed in, and we will gradually increase the set. If we allow any vertex, then of course we will get arbitrary shortest paths. So recall that vertices are numbered 1 to n. So we will compute a quantity wk of ij to be the weight of the shortest path from I to j, where we restrict the vertices that can be used to go from I to j to be between 1 and k. In other words, we have the set of vertices v. Right? So we cut it off saying we have 1 to k and we have k plus 1 to n. And we say that only these vertices can be used in the path. Now the endpoints themselves need not be, but if the point is that if the endpoint is outside, okay, then it can still, so I could have one vertex here and then it could have a path which goes like this and then come back here. Right? So it only says that the intermediate vertices, so when I start with I and go to j, what happens in between lies in the set 1 to k, right? So in particular, if k is 0 because our numbering is 1 to n, it says that the vertices that can appear cannot be include 1. So in other words, if I have w0, then it says all of the vertices 1 to n cannot appear on the path. So the only way that we can have such a shortest path is with a direct edge, right? So w0, the base case of this inductive definition, says that the shortest paths between I and J, which exclude all vertices from 1 to n, are of the form edges between I and J. Okay. So now, since this is an inductive definition, what we have to say is, supposing we know the shortest paths which use 1 to k minus 1, then how do I compute the shortest paths that use 1 to k? Right. So we know all among all the paths which use at most 1 to k minus 1, what is the shortest path from I to J? How do we now compute, if we allow vertex k also to be used, how do you compute what would be the shortest path from I to j? So there are two cases. The first case is that this extra vertex k is not useful. The shortest path, even if I include k, does not use vertex k. It's enough to use 1 to k minus 1. In this case, the shortest distance from I to j using 1 to k is the same as the shortest distance from I to j using k minus 1. So I can say wk of ij is the same as wk minus 1 ij. On the other hand, it could be that using K does give us a non-trivial improvement, right? So we have now some path which goes from I to J, and on the way it visits K. So if it visits K on the way, then we can break it up as a path from I to K and a path from K to J. But notice that we have already said that this vertex K, or any vertex for that matter, which appears on this path, if it is the shortest path, appears only once. Right? So if K appears here, there is no K between I and K, and there is no K between K and J. This means that I have a path from I to K already, which goes through 1 to K minus 1. And I have a path from K to J already, which goes through 1 to K minus 1, and I am combining these two. Right? So I can break up the path as a path from I to K and a path to K to J, each of which uses only 1 to K minus 1. And what is the cost of that path? Well, we inductively know that we have the cost of the best path from I to K using only 1 to K minus 1 in WK minus 1. We also have the best path from K to J in our matrix WK minus 1. So if I add these two, this must be the best way of going by K. Right? So combining the cases, we say that either we don't use K, in which case we take the value of the old matrix, or we do use K, in which case we combine two entries going via K in the old matrix, and we take the smaller of these two. Right? So whichever one of these is smaller will be the correct value of the shortest distance from I to J going through 1 to K. So this gives us an immediate algorithm, which is called the Floyd-Warshall algorithm. So we start off with a matrix representing the function W0. So W0 has entries which are exactly the edge weights. So if there is an edge from I to J, so W0 I to J says there's a direct path of that weight. Because remember, W0 cannot go through any intermediate paths. And if there's no edge, since I can't go through any intermediate vertex, W0 I j must be infinity. Now for k in 1 to n, I basically repeat this n times. I first allow 1 to be used. So I compute W1 from W0. And how do I do that? I use the update rule we said earlier, that is, you take the minimum of what you already have plus the possibility of going through the newly introduced vertex. Then I allow 1 and 2, then I allow 1, 2 and 3. And obviously, if I have allowed 1, 2, 3 up to n, I have allowed all the vertices to appear in between. Wn will now have the shortest paths with no constraints. So I need to do this update exactly n times, so that after n times, I have captured the shortest weight paths which include any arbitrary combination of vertices on the path. So the actual code is again like Bellman-Ford, extremely straightforward. Right? You just have first an initialization which sets every weight to infinity and then updates the non-trivial weights for those edges which are in the graph. So we are keeping track of this function W0 of ij by a three-dimensional matrix. So I and j represent the two vertices, and the 0 represents the iteration number. Right? So initially, W0ij is either the weight of ij if there is an edge, or it's infinity, and that's what these first two steps are doing. And now we do this n times, we do this iteration, that is, we update all the wijs at level k to be the minimum of the wijs at level k minus 1 or the sum of the two. Right? So implicitly here should have been written, so this is for I in for I equal to 1 to n, for j equal to 1 to n. Okay? So we have this update rule, and we do this blindly n times, and at the end we claim that the matrix W in the entry k has got the correct shortest paths for all pairs of vertices. So let's look at the same example that we saw for Bellman-Ford. Okay? So initially we assign to each, so W0, okay, has the edge weight. So we have an adjacency matrix like representation in which, for instance, we say 1 to 2 there's an edge of weight 10, 7 to 6 there's an edge of weight minus 1, and so on. Right? So we just duplicate all of these edges in the matrix, and everything else is left at infinity. Now from W0 we go to W1 by considering all new paths that we can find by going from 1. But now notice that there is nothing that is coming into 1. So this is signified by the fact that the column 1 has infinity. No edge goes into 1. So no other vertex can use the fact that 1 is connected to 2 and 8. Right? So if you update using update rule, you will find that W1 is actually equal to W0. Nothing changes, because allowing 1 to be used in between two vertices doesn't help us. It is not in between any two vertices. I cannot go from anywhere to 1 and then from 1 to that vertex. On the other hand, if I can now include 2, then I can do interesting things. I can go, for example, from 1 to 2 to 6. And I can go from 7 to 1 to 6. Right? So allowing 2 and 1 as an intermediate vertex, so 1 doesn't help right now, but allowing 2 gives me something. So if I now look at W1, I don't need W0 anymore. If I look at W1, then I will, as I said, be able to explore paths through 2. So in particular, 2 goes to 6. So anything pointing into 2, so 7 to 2 to 6, 3 to 2 to 6, and 1 to 2 to 6. These three entries will get updated. Right? So 1 to 2 to 6, so I get a new entry 12. 3 to 2 to 6, so I get a new entry 3. And 7 to 2 to 6, so I get minus 4 plus 2 is minus 2. Okay. Now from W2, likewise, I'll do compute W3. Again, to compute W3, we'll come back to this later. I don't need W1, I only need W2. So I can throw away W1 for now and just look at W2. Right? So now having got, now I'm allowing myself to use 1, 2, 3. So I will look for things that can go through 3. Right? So for instance, now through 3, I can go from 6 to 4, for example. Okay? So I will get entries of that form. So I can go from 6 to 4 with a new thing. I can also go from 6 to 2. Right? So now I have a new way of going from 6 to 2. Okay? So that also gets updated. And interestingly, I also discovered that there is now a path from 6 to 6. Because earlier I didn't know that, but now that I'm allowed to go through both 2 and 3, I can go from 6 to 6. So I've discovered this loop which has a positive weight. If it didn't have a positive weight, we were in trouble because this didn't have a well-defined solution and so on. Okay, so you can just keep on doing this. We will not update up to W. But if you would now go all the way and you go up to W8, okay, then after you allow everything from 1 to 8 to be an intermediate thing, this matrix will actually compute all pair shortest path between any ij. So this algorithm, it is very easy to see that the complexity is order n cubed because you have n iteration, and in each iteration we are updating the entire matrix which has n square entries. Okay, so there's not much you can do to improve this because it is an adjacency matrix based algorithm. We cannot move to lists, we don't have to compute any minimum, maximum, so there's nothing much we can do. It's an n cubed algorithm. Okay? Notice that it sort of solves as a trivial case the Bellman-Ford algorithm, because once you've computed all pairs, okay, so this generalizes as a solution, Bellman-Ford, because in particular, if you now want all the shortest path from a given S to everything, you just have to look up that particular row in the Floyd-Warshall matrix, right? You look at the row S and all the entries will say the shortest path from S. But remember that in that particular case, if I only wanted from S, Bellman-Ford with a clever adjacency list representation would take order mn, whereas here this will require order n cube, right? So this does generalize Bellman-Ford in the sense you get the same answers that you would have got from Bellman-Ford and more, but you are always spending n cube time, whereas if you have very few edges in your graph, which is typically the case, Bellman-Ford will be more efficient. So if you are using, you only want to do single source shortest path, you should not typically jump directly to Floyd-Warshall, you should probably do Bellman-Ford instead. About space complexity, so we said that we are going to represent each W0, W1, etc. as one coordinate. So we have basically have n times n times n, because we have n times n is the actual matrix, and we have n of these matrices because we have level 0, level 1, and up to level k, level n, right? But we saw that in our worked out example that when you need to compute the level 1, we only need level 0. Then we can throw away level 0. And when you need to compute level 2, you need only level 1. So in some sense, you can keep only 2 copies and keep switching back and forth. Right? You overwrite the 0th level as a second level, you overwrite the first level as a third level, and so on. So you need only 2 slices, as I'll call it, of this 3-dimensional matrix at a time. So you can just keep oscillating between these 2 slices. So overall, you have 2n squared space. Right? So we don't normally worry about space, but just an observation that in this particular thing, you don't really need to have this n cubed array. You can have 2n squared array or an n squared array with 2 indices and keep oscillating between the 2 and get the same effect because you only need 1 copy to compute the other copy. So let's conclude this discussion with some historical remarks. So Floyd-Warshall, as you can see from the hyphenation, is a hybrid name for this algorithm, and actually there are 2 distinct algorithms which comprise it, which have a very similar structure. So the original algorithm, which was proposed by Warshall, is for what is called transitive closure. So transitive closure is exactly the same as computing a path from edge relation. So supposing you have a relationship like friend, right? So you know among a group of people who is a direct friend of whom. then you might want to ask, who knows indirectly, right? So I know somebody indirectly if I have a friend who knows that person, or if I have a friend who has a friend who knows that person, and so on. So knowing somebody indirectly is the transitive closure of the friend relation. In the same way, in a general, I mean, so in every graph, if you put the friend or the whatever relation you want as the edge relation, the transitive closure is a path relation, right? So you want to have, you have an adjacency matrix which represents the edges. You want to compute a path matrix which represents the paths, which are the pairs of vertices computed by, which are connected by paths. And so Warshall described the similar algorithm what we wrote now, and we will just do it in a little detail in the next couple of slides to do this, compute P from A. And what Floyd observed was that you can adapt the same algorithm. So in Warshall's algorithm, you're only checking, is there a path? And Floyd's algorithm says that you can actually adapt it to compute shortest paths. So the idea is very similar to what we've seen before. Let's go through it quickly. So we have an adjacency matrix A, which tells us the edges. So Aj, Aij is 1 if there is an edge. And we want a path matrix, Pij is 1 if there is a path from I to j. So we will again compute iteratively this quantity Pkij, which says that there is a path, and this path uses only the vertices in 1 to k. So k plus 1 to n cannot appear in the path, right? And again, the endpoints are not included. So I and j are arbitrary. It's what is between I and j which is restricted by this superscript k, right? So between I and j, you can only see things from 1 to k. So as before, if you do p0, it says nothing can appear because you rule out everything from 1 to n. Okay, therefore, p0 is just the adjacency matrix. Okay? So now we have a very similar update rule. So if I know the paths which can be discovered using 1 to k minus 1, what are the paths I can discover using 1 to k? Right? So if there is a path already without using k, then I can just keep that path. So we could either have that pki. So remember now, this is there a path, is there not a path? So this is like an adjacency matrix, there's no weight. So it's a 0-1 matrix or a true-false matrix. So initially the adjacency matrix has 1 or true whenever there is an edge, false whenever there's no edge. So if I've already got an entry true with k minus 1, then I can keep it. On the other hand, maybe I don't have an entry true, I have to go by k. But once again, that means that there is a path from I to k, and there's a path from k to j. And here I use only k minus 1, and here I use only k minus 1 because k needs to appear only once. Just like in the shortest path, if I'm just looking for some connectivity, I don't gain anything by going back from k to k, because I can just remove that and I and j will remain connected, right? So I need to only look for paths which have one copy of every vertex along them. So therefore, I can assume there is a path from I to k which does not use anything outside 1 to k minus 1, and likewise from k to j. So here now, instead of min and plus, my operations now become OR and AND. So either I want a path from I to K and a path from K to J, or I want an existing path from I to J which never used K at all, right? So I have this AND operation for combining these two existing paths. So this should be P, sorry. And then I have an OR operation which combines it with case 1, right? So earlier we had W K minus 1 IJ. And then we add this wk minus 1 ik plus wk minus 1 kj, and we took the min of this. Okay. So here, instead of this plus, we are using AND, and instead of this min, we are using OR. Right. So you can see that the algorithm is not exactly the same, but it's very similar. So this was the algorithm proposed by Warshall. Right. So you initialize everything to false, and then again, this should be for I is equal to n, or j is equal to 1 to n. So you initialize all the paths to false, then you set explicitly that the 0th level paths are true if there is an edge, and then you keep updating the kth level path by either saying that there was already a k minus 1 level path, or I can find 2 k minus 1 level paths via an intermediate level k, intermediate vertex k. Right? So it's a very similar thing, we just have these operations of OR and AND instead of min and plus. And then Warshall's algorithm was used for transitive closure, and Floyd generalized it for shortest paths. And these work in the presence of negative edges, it doesn't matter. Floyd's algorithm doesn't care whether the edges are negative or positive, so long as there are no negative cycles.